So tell us what Flagship does.
Yeah. So Flagship, Flagship is first and foremost a life science innovation company. We have our own way by which we innovate, which I'll tell you about. Yeah. Once we come up with something that's worth taking forward, we form a company to take that forward. And so we also had to figure out how to do venture creation in a systematic way. We have our own capital, then we deploy into these companies to help them grow for the first 2-3 years. So up until then, they operate as wholly owned pieces of Flagship. And then we spin them out. And we spin them out, and for the first time, additional capital comes in. But by that time, the culture, the senior leadership team, the early proof of concept, the early kind of customer or partner traction is there. And it looks like a company ready to eventually live its life on its own. So we're not interested in building kind of subsidiaries open-endedly. Every single thing we do ends up becoming a company,
yes,
or nothing.
Yeah.
But so we've become kind of a creator of companies around internal innovations. Mm. Now, sometimes these innovations draw from external science, and I can describe that.
Yes.
But we're not only trying to find science and then find what to do with it and create companies. That's become in vogue the last few years. We've been doing this for 18 years. But we've ended up in a place where we think the sustainable way to do this is to have your own innovation capacity, your own company creation capacity, initial growth, and then the companies have the wherewithal to grow and compete and thrive.
That's fascinating. So walk us through one example of a company that you guys have given birth to from the start to, you know, it's leaving the Flagship full.
There are many. I think we've been involved in doing about 50 of these that are based on internally developed science, and there's a whole bunch more that also include external. But I'd say one of the internally developed ones that just recently went public, I can give as an example, is Moderna.
Yeah.
So Moderna was, and I'll tell you kind of this, we have this fairly, let's say, prescribed process, which the way people think about entrepreneurship and innovation, especially breakthrough innovation, is that it is unruly, it is chaotic, it is inspired.
And serendipity.
In my view, it's none of those things.
It's none of those things.
Absolutely none of those things. I have a completely contrarian view of that, and I've done it enough times in enough different fields that I think, frankly, just to be a little controversial, I think that's an illusion. In other words, I think that because people haven't done that thing before, it's exciting and unexpected to them.
Yes.
But actually, pretty quickly, it looks like just another version of what came before them, because the historians come and say, well, you know, before there was the iPad, there was the iPod, and before that, there was the Walkman, etc.
Yes.
And also, when you look at it that way, you go, well, why were you surprised?
Yes.
And that's when you realize that these things are just evolving.
Mm.
And so I'll give you an example in this company called Moderna. But before that, I'll tell you that underlying how we think you can do this systematically is the notion that breakthroughs aren't made by people.
Mm.
They emerge.
Mm.
And the most understood, not well understood, but understood version of emergence that we know about is evolution, which is that if you do variation, iteration, selection and iteration systematically, you will, the winners will emerge.
Yes.
And when they do, they will look surprising, but actually they're the result of that process. They're not some inspired thought that has nothing to do with that process.
Mm.
So hold that thought as I give examples. They'll all be examples of that. And that actually does cause, you know, one to think differently about being possessive about all these companies and all these innovations. We're not.
Yeah.
We don't go around saying we invented this.
Yes.
We may file a patent and get an invention, but where these ideas come from are very emergent. So in Moderna's case, talking about emergence, we understood by following the various scientific advances that people were playing around with converting fibroblast cells into what's called induced pluripotent stem cells.
Yes.
These are, you know, if somebody won a Nobel Prize recently for this, these are called Yamanaka factors. So it turns out that if you take differentiated cells and you introduce a couple, three different proteins, four of them specifically, these cells can de-differentiate and look like what came before them, stem cells. They're not normal stem cells, but they're close to being stem cells. And so why do that? Because then you can differentiate it and make other cells. So that was the general field. And in that field, there had been some people, particularly at UPenn and then more recently at Children's Hospital here in Boston, who had been playing around with using what's called mRNA, messenger RNA, to use these to go into cells and express these proteins. Why had they done that? Because it turns out this mRNA, they could actually get a better transformation of these cells. And so we were aware of this work. And we started asking kind of just what-if questions.
So your team is reading scientific papers, it's in the air.
Yeah, in this case, exactly. And we do this all the time. Yeah. So basically we're
in the mix of this flow of knowledge.
Exactly. It's not about reading papers for us as much as just, I mean, we are talking to lots of people about lots of different things.
Yes.
And then, or somebody says, hey, by the way, you know, I just saw this data.
Yeah.
And then we actually read papers in hindsight.
Yeah.
In other words, we read papers once we have an idea of what to do, as opposed to read papers to get an idea per se, because there's, you know, the signal to noise in papers is gigantic.
Yes.
You can't, you know, if you sit there and read 1,000 papers and then gives you 3 ideas, hard to do anything else. So I'm sure that can be done too, but that's not the way we approach it. Anyway, so long story short, we started wondering, for lots of reasons that I can't almost reproduce, because you'd have to go back to 2010 in the summer and whatever else was being thought of at the time.
Yeah.
So understand, by that time, we had about 20 people that were doing this type of activity in various combinations for a living.
Yeah.
And so it's important, because these ideas kind of get mixed and moved around. This is not a one person thinking deeply is not going to get there. So we started asking, you know, can you think about, we started, why isn't there no drug that is based on mRNA? Now, if you go back 10 years, drugs were made out of proteins and small molecules. There had been an effort to use viruses to introduce genes into the body called gene therapy, and, you know, a person had died early on, and that whole field was shut down. And there really was no other variation to proteins and small molecules. And there had been some efforts to try to make, you know, not to get too detailed, but other small DNA, RNA molecules, antisense, what's called, and we were aware of all this, but we were thinking, why don't people actually use this microRNA molecule? And that's just a thought experiment, and you can go and answer that question.
So you raise the problem.
You raise a what-if problem. You don't say, you know, initially, we don't start with, we need to cure melanoma. We don't start the problem, you know, what good is this mRNA that can transform cells, because it's not good for anything other than that.
Yeah.
But we kind of abstracted and said, is there a combination of a solution and a problem that we can identify simultaneously around this space? And if there isn't one, then we move on. And in this case, that's part of our methodology. In this case, what we concluded was that people had tried and failed 10 years earlier. We understood why they tried and failed. We realized that there was no obvious fix to it, but there was a directional fix in that you could modify chemically some of these RNA molecules, and they at least hinted that if you kept doing that, there may be better ways. We had no proof. There was no academic literature that said this can be done. Now, we could have waited for that, but we probably would have been 5-6 years, because now there is academic papers from which we could have started companies.
Sure.
But our whole thing is to almost mine this, you know, science of the future to try to solve problems of today versus mind the science of today to solve problems of the future. And that is exactly backwards.
Yeah.
And it's not any better. It's just that you look at the world differently. So publications give you evidence for what you want to do, but that's not why they published those things. They were thinking of a very different thing.
Problem, yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying? So in that regard, that's a little bit. So in Moderna's case, we identified... Well, the other thing that we do, a very integral part of what we do, is that we don't do this in a vacuum. So we go out and talk to people about our hypotheses. These are not...
Are you not afraid of people taking your ideas?
No, and I'll tell you why. So we have this... So we use, in order to try to create an evolution... So we're trying to create an evolutionary environment. How do you do that? The scientific method uses hypotheses and experimentation.
Yes.
So we actually do the same thing. We create value hypotheses.
Mm.
We basically say, I will take an mRNA molecule, formulate it with this agent, stick it into muscle, use muscle to... None of it is true. None of it has been done before. But it's just a starting point. We then go with that to a handful of folks that are both experts and non-experts in the field. Super important thing if you're going to practice this kind of work is that experts actually are not the people who are going to give you an idea of how to do things dramatically differently, because they became experts by already doing something dramatically differently, and now they're defending their territory.
Yeah.
So if you go to talk to somebody and say, can this be done out here? Most people we talk to they can tell you precisely why it can't be done, yes. which is really valuable yes. from a selection pressure standpoint, yes. but not the source of kind of, and here's a completely different way. Yes. So other people, though, who don't have expertise but have interesting creativity, so what we do is we take our hypotheses, and it's never one, because one of the things we've learned is that if you start with one starting point, you only locally search the space around it. So we sample multiple different points. So it might be, how about mRNA as a way to make more proteins in a fermenter? How about, so around the theme, we come up with totally different value pools we try to identify. And then we put a starting point, and then we start talking. And when what's been interesting and a great learning exercise over the years that we've seen is that if you go to somebody with a bad idea, but you actually present it in a precise way, they will tell you why it's a bad idea. And in that transaction, something happens. They feel smarter.
Yes.
And you get selection pressure.
Yes.
And so the way our process works is that we actually do this with multiple people. So when you said, aren't you afraid they're going to take your idea? What are they taking? We just made it up.
Yes.
There's zero fact to it. Yes. Literally zero fact. Yes.
You're so just imagining
it. Exactly. We're just a hypothesis. And they know it.
Yes.
Because then they tell us, what proof do you have? I said, none.
Yeah.
So then they still engage because it's almost, when we talk to these folks, and this is what we're known for, we create a bit of an expert-free zone in the sense that look, these scientists, here we are at Harvard and MIT, Stanford, these people go to the meetings of their fields, and they cannot say something that does not seem unbelievably smart and reasonable. Actually, I'll make the point, let me caveat. Reasonableness, in my view, is like the gravitational force that keeps innovation from happening. Hmm. Because people enforce reasonableness in the scientific world on what you are allowed to say.
Hmm.
You go publish something in literature that's not reasonable to the reviewers, you can't publish it.
You're killed. I've done a whole study on that.
Right. Yes. So ask yourself the question, why is it that we think that the only innovations worth working on start their life reasonably? In fact, I can show you many innovations that are now accepted as real transformative things. Every one of them started life unreasonably.
Yeah.
And yet, we go look for them in reasonable places by reasonable people who are using reasonableness filters to kill them. Yeah. So because we knew that, and this was not the first thing I had done, we kind of say, look, let's forget reasonableness for a second. Just think with us. And they tell us, bad idea, somebody in Japan had tried it, the experiment won't work. And we keep tweaking and tweaking and tweaking. This is different than kind of like you hear a lot in Silicon Valley speak, kind of pivoting. This is not pivoting. Evolution is the master pivot. It's like nonstop pivoting, right? There's nothing to pivot from and to. You're just adapting and surviving. So that mindset is super important. Now, what happens is over time, things emerge, or they don't, but they emerge where the next person you talk to goes, they can't find fault with it.
Mm.
You know that because it frustrates them.
Yeah.
And then they start telling you, well, do you have any proof? And you go, no, I just made this up. It's just that we've been iterating. And then that point is when we go into a lab for the first time. And then and only then do we test the idea. Now, you can't test it fully. You can't test it where, because it takes years and years. But we try to, and one of the expertise we've developed over the years is how to figure out what to test first.
Mm.
And this in the, in life science, you can't use these words, killer experiment, because, life science you can kill. But you want to do the killer experiment early.
Yes.
And so figuring out what's the killer experiment, or two or three or four, that if it doesn't fail, allows you to go forward, that's the trick. And we do that in our shop. So in Moderna's case, we spent a couple of $1 million, about 6 months, doing a set of key things, but for which we would not have proceeded. So we knew the idea had morphed and evolved and it had some resilience to it.
Yeah.
We went into labs and asked specific questions. Once we saw that actually some of the things we were hypothesizing could be done, partially, we then decided, let's form the best economic value creation engine known to mankind, which is a startup, in my view, I'm biased, and then we deploy that startup to go after that value pool in as many different ways as we can.